I'm looking up and leaving. And anybody we can lose it all. Make the drop of a hat, got time to turn your back and move on. A lot of us feel like we do it, thinking that we're just too alone. But I want you to know, there's still a hope for you now. No matter what you've done, you can't erase it from. Nothing changed, not separated, no matter what. Never been a better time to get honest. There's never been a better time to get clean. So come as you are, run through the cross and be free. Oh, be free. No matter what you've done, you can't erase his love. Nothing can change, not separated. No matter where you run, he's always holding on. You're still a daughter, you're still a son.
You're still a son, no matter what. knock us through up and breathing. And anybody we can lose it all. Let the drop of a hat, that kind of turn his back and move on. A lot of us feel like we do it, thinking that we're just too alone. But I want you to know, there's still a hope for you now. No matter what you've done, you can be great in love. Nothing can change it, not separated, no matter what.
Thank you. need to. You may sit, you may stand, you may jump up and down, you may clap, you can do whatever you need to do to make this a worship experience for you. Today we are talking about faith. It's a topic so important in our lives, yet elusive, misunderstood, and personal. It is easy to discuss this concept, but in reality, each of us, you and I, experience faith in different ways. We hear God in different ways, and the scriptures speak to us in different ways. And yet, for some, faith is all we need, and for others, faith is all about works. We are called to live a life of faith, and what that looks like have been discussions since before Jesus walked this earth. And just like the ancients before us, and those who shaped what we consider to be Christianity, we will all struggle with what faith is. You and I, to walk with God, to have a relationship with God, we need to have faith. And let us worship a faith that continues in oppression, injustice, inequities, unfairnesses, discrimination, loss, illness, trauma, and disaster. Let us worship with the joy of faith that abounds in all times and in all ways. So let us begin our worship today with the focus on using faith to refresh and restart.
Good morning, church family, and how are you all today? It is so good to see you. I hope that you all had a great week and that you are excited to be worshiping our Lord together here at St. Andrew's. Even though it's not a very nice day outside, we want to bring the sunshine in and we want to smile. We want to be excited. We're worshiping our Lord and Savior. So please bring the sunshine in. Let the merry sunshine in. And we welcome everybody, those who are here, those who are online, and our visitors. Today is the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. Oh God, my heart is quiet and confident. No wonder I can sing your praises. Rouse yourself, my soul. Let us greet the dawn with psalms and songs. Let us begin our worship with Gospel Road singing Amen and Praise God to you. And you're singing with us, right? Everybody's going to be singing. We're excited. And listen, when we say Amen, it's up on the board. Whenever you say it really loud. Amen. Amen. And especially at the end, at the very, very end, you're going to shout Amen so that they hear it down the road. So sing joyously in your hearts. And all God's people said, Amen.
Thank you. So verse B says to sing, to glide, to dance, to laugh, to smile. And why? Because of God's grace. We should be so happy that God has given us his grace, because we most certainly don't deserve it.
Thank you.
my voice. I'm going to take my mask off when I'm up here. I apologize for that, but if not, I'm going to lose my voice. And although that could be a good thing, I want to preach that. But let's get to it. So anyway, I just know that will happen. So a couple things on the life of the church. In your handouts, there's just three things I want to highlight. One is a financial statement of where we're at as a church. We are beginning with the finance group to have this be put in a periodic way. I don't think we know our complete frequency yet. But if you notice, and there's some narrative on the one side, we are over our budget by about $6,500. In this time, we recognize that's an incredible place for us to be. It could be worse. It could also be better. And so we are going to continue just highlighting where we're at financially. And we will be doing a stewardship and service campaign somewhere middle October to November and kind of incorporating Thanksgiving into it. But if you have any questions, you can see anybody on the finance team, you can see myself, and we can talk to you about this. Just don't ask me about that last right number, because I still don't understand accounting where you take a negative and add a positive and still come out with a negative. As an engineer, that's not supposed to happen, but in accounting, apparently it does. Which is probably why I'm not an accountant or an engineer. Anyway, so that's where we're at. Ask questions if you need it. The other two things I just want to mention real quick is on September 5th, it is the Sunday before Labor Day. So we're going to have a blended worship experience in the sanctuary, another unity service. We're going to look at achieving unity using James. And so that's also in your bulletin. And then the last one is the rally for youth got canceled on August 28th. So what we're going to do here is we're just going to be anywhere from anybody from 6th through 12th grade. We're going to be there. Any adult who wants to be part of this too, we're going to organize a youth room. We're going to play games. We're going to dive into fascinating discussions on who is God and what does it mean to have faith. And then we're going to end with some grilling and some s'mores. So we're going to do some youth groups up here. Questions, just ask me. Anywhere from 6th through 12th grade, we're going to do that. For those that are under 6th grade, come and talk to me, because we're going to try to figure out something for that group too. But that's what we're going to do, because we can't get to the rally on the 28th.
Yes, so also in your bulletin is the Christian education philosophy. And if you open it up, there's a survey. We really would like your feedback and what you're interested in, so we can create the Christian education part of our worship next month. So please, if you can, please fill it out, because you're all important to us.
All right, so we've been doing this recognition of service and ministry, and so I'm going to make a very global kind of recognition right now. And just raise your hand or stand if you're already standing. Anybody who is part of the Sunday morning experience of making this happen. So no matter how small or big that you are a part of, raise your hand if you're a part of how we make this happen on Sunday mornings. Don, you have to raise your hand, because you do great. So anyway, let's give a round of applause to those people that make sure that we are open on Sunday mornings. That oftentimes those services in the back, so to speak, in which people don't see it, are often unrecognized, and we fully recognize what it takes to get everyone in the door on a Sunday morning. So thank you for those, for that service. And so now, part again, the life of the church. As you notice, we have a lot of school supplies up here. And those school supplies have been donated by many people over much time. And Keith has actually organized this, I guess, for years. Do you want to say anything, Keith, about the program? They go over to
Willowdale
and Log Middle School.
Willowdale uses it for anybody that needs it, and it includes some of the kids at Block College or even over at McDonald's, because they have extra things over there.
So Willowdale kind of coordinates all that, and they give these out to people who need it. And so it could be a full backpack, it could just be a tablet. It depends on what they need, correct?
Yeah, generally, usually when these help the most is during the year, when the kids run out of stuff, and they can supply them without the parents having to go get it. But the fact they actually said there's a couple people that have contacted them that they're waiting for the supplies to get there so they can give them to people.
Great. So it's not just for the beginning of the school year, it's throughout the year as those supplies are still there that if somebody needs it.
And you know, my novel said one story.
Actually, do you want to come up here, Keith? So,
no, it's
okay. But Facebook and YouTube can't see you right now. So just imagine somebody sitting in the back of the church talking, like God, if you're on Facebook or YouTube.
Good. A couple years ago, we gave One of the first times we gave the backpacks, one of the counselors told me about a little girl who evidently was in second or third grade and still had like this little 6-inch square backpack that she used for kindergarten. And nobody had, they had to go to the airport to get the new one. She did run her into the office and they gave her, and they actually gave her brother stuff too, gave her a full backpack. She said she was bouncing off the wall. She was walking around showing off the backpack to everybody, the school bus, the bus drivers, and the teachers. And she was like, she said her whole attitude had changed from when she walked around the school and dealing with other people in the school because of what we had provided her for. So just a thank you to everybody.
It's a wonderful story.
And so that's another recognition of service. There's somebody taking care to collect the supplies so that children can have the necessary means to educate. So we're going to bless this group of school supplies, and it'll include all the ones that are in the church. And we're Methodists, and we love doing this stuff. You're welcome to raise your hand up, and as if we're all kind of blessing it together, I'll just lead us in that. So you may stand, you may raise both hands, you can raise one hand, but our intention here is to bless this material. So let us pray. Oh God, the God of learning, the God who always sustains, even in those times when there's not enough, for in this world there is enough. And so we ask your holy divine presence, the presence that Jesus brought with him on this earth, the same presence when he blessed those around him, when he said, "Go, your faith has made you well." We ask for your Holy Spirit to descend upon these backpacks and school supplies, both in this location and in our narthex and in our sanctuary. We ask for your blessing that for those that use them, for those in need, they are able to safely educate themselves. They are able to participate in education in ways that do not divide them, do not put them off, but let them be part of the whole. We ask for your blessing on these materials so that they can become the children that you know them to be, that they can develop in ways that give back, that they can develop in ways that let them be successful. We ask for that blessing, for we know that through you all things are possible. So for these children and these families who feel it's impossible to start school and maintain school, let the impossible become possible. Let these gifts flow in ways that make hearts jump for joy, just like the story that Keith shared with us. Let every child that receives something feel your presence in that gift. We ask this through your Son who came to die for us, who showed us a sacrifice of love so that we know how much you love us. Bless these materials, these school supplies and backpacks, so that those that receive them can feel your love. In your Son's name we offer this prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now that brings us to another blessing. And so we are honored to have a baptism happen here today. We're going to do the baptism behind on our slide. Look at that. Somebody else needs to control that. All right. Thank you. And so we're going to do a blessing of the water and an anointing. So we're blessed to have this opportunity to do this. So we're going to bring up my little child. Come on up, Mary. Let us begin our blessing. God, who through water and the Holy Spirit has given us a new birth in Christ, is present with us as we prepare the water for baptism.
The blessing of this water reminds us of Christ, the living water, and of the sacrament of baptism, in which we were born of water and the Holy Spirit. Therefore, when we use this water for baptism, we thank God for God's priceless gift to us, and we ask for God's protection and help as we grow in faith and become faithful following Jesus. In John 7, verses 37 through 38, we hear this: "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me." On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood up and exclaimed, "Let anyone who thirsts come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture says, rivers of living water will flow from within him."
So let us pray. And let us pray in silence first. And in this silence, may you hear God's calling in your life, tugging on your heart. Oh God, silence can scare us so much, so often. But yet it's in the silence that your blessings occur. It is in the silence in which we feel your love and your grace. And so blessed are you, Lord, all-powerful God, who in Christ, the living water of salvation, blessed and transformed us. Grant that when we are sprinkled with this water, make use of it, we will be refreshed inwardly by the power of the Holy Spirit and continue to walk in new life with you. Let this water be an outward sign of grace, a grace that is present before we are aware of it, a grace that is present when we say yes, and a grace that guides us as we walk in faith with you. We ask this through Christ our Redeemer, Sustainer, and Creator. Amen.
Amen.
And so, this water reminds us, for those who have baptized, your own baptism, as we prepare to bless this water to be used, may it remind you of your baptism and your faith in God in Christ. Oh God, the creator of all things, by water and the Holy Spirit, you have given the universe's beauty and fashioned us in your own image. In the name of the Father, bless this water. O Christ the Lord, from your pure side, you gave us the sacraments as fountains of salvation. In the name of the Son, bless this water. O Holy Spirit, giver of life, from the baptismal font of the church, you have formed us into a new creation in the waters of rebirth. In the name of the Holy Spirit, bless this water. Let this water remind us that Christ calls each of us to transformation by the Spirit through a covenant that can never be taken away from you. Amen. And now our water is blessed. And we're going to do one more thing. This is frankincense from Egypt. I'm going to do an anointing of the family as we prepare for baptism. Look how cute you are. You are a child of God forever. Amen. Show time's going to start at 11 o'clock, okay? That'll be show two. All right. Amen. Thank you. We are now ready. Joys, we just bless the water, so we have a baptism. What are other joys you have?
I have enjoyed that our pastor Betty is going to be 25 again.
She seems to keep following me on things. Yes, a celebration of life. Other joys.
Jessica made it through quarantine. My daughter Jessica made it through quarantine. She's now at the university for a week of in-school orientation. I talked to her this morning. I think it's a little bit of homesickness is starting to set in. And she has to have blood work done tomorrow. And she's petrified of needles. So if we can mix that with a prayer. But she's befriended a girl who's from Manchester, England. And the campus, I don't remember the name of the university, but it is just beautiful, and they've been walking around. So now that she's out of the hotel room, I think, you know, things are going to go. So just prayers for a good week of orientation, and she gets an assignment that she wants, and an apartment that's good, and I think she'll be good.
Excellent. So prayers for new beginnings in lots of different ways.
Good morning. I just wanted to thank the Lord for a successful move-in for Nick and Kate, and I pray that He be with them all semester. And also, I wanted to have some prayers for my aunt just passed away, and I want to just pray for us as well as my cousins right now, the loss of their mother.
So prayers for those that moved into college, and prayers for those that have moved forward in this world. I know Colleen took her daughter on Thursday. Yeah.
My joy is for you, Pastor Dave, and thank you for calling to see if everything was going okay with me this week, and for checking about my dad, who did make it through his hip surgery successfully.
Great, great, wonderful. So, joys for successful surgeries. Other joys?
I have a joy.
Okay.
Yesterday we had a really fine man's breakfast. I'd like to invite all the other men who we have home every month, and we'll try to let y'all know when we get it scheduled.
Excellent. So joy for breakfast. That's a joy I have every day. And it's a joy I have to delay on Sunday mornings until the afternoon. Just saying. So if somebody brings me breakfast, that'd be a great joy. I'm just joking. Not really. Anyway, go on.
Just obviously the joy of our beautiful girl being baptized today, but also having my parents and her Mandy's parents and family and friends here today, being able to celebrate a special day.
Yes. Yeah. A joy for a special moment in the life of the church or baptism. Other joys.
Big thank you to Mandy and Jay for watching our animals while we're on vacation last week.
How many animals are there?
Two dogs.
I think you're like a little farmer.
No,
there's two dogs, two turtles, and fish.
And you watched your kid at the same time. That's impressive.
So,
joy for the kid, animals. Any other joys? All right, what are some concerns? We heard some for grieving and loss and moving forward and recovery from surgeries. Others?
My dad's surgery is this coming Wednesday, so some prayers. He's having an ankle replacement, and he's 85. My boss's mother's surgery got postponed until September. She doesn't know why yet. The office was closed. And then just some prayers for the kids that are going back to school on Thursday at Centennial.
Yes. And I did talk to most of our homebound, if not all of them, so just prayers for continued healing. People are up and down in their journeys of their illnesses. And I think somebody is watching Facebook, so Facebook, if you have anything, just post it for us. Nothing out there yet? Okay.
I'd just like to ask for prayers for all the students and teachers going back to school in a really uncertain time. I think we're all nervous. All stressed out, so just prayers that we can all get through it without losing our mind.
I'd like prayers for my friend's husband. His name is Chris. He has leukemia, and he just had a cell stem transplant from his sister. So far things are looking good. So again, his name is Chris.
Carol, the person that you keep bringing up in prayer, how are they doing? child right behind you.
I'm asking for prayers because between Monday and Tuesday of this week, I'm supposed to get a determination from the PUA people that I've been waiting for 11 months on. There is no reason for them to delay 11 months. Everybody looks at my profile, says there's no reason for me to not be get a positive reaction, and I am desperately in need of the money that I lost last year. So if you guys could pray for me, hopefully I will finally get this money that I'm entitled to.
Great. Over here. How are you doing?
I'd like to pray for the ACTA people and also for Foley, for Sculptor.
Yeah.
And also for our presidency, both past and present.
Yeah, so for government, for what's happening in Afghanistan, for our military, and also for all of the, there's flooding in Tennessee, I think 10 people passed away from flooding, just from our own natural disasters here, our country and others. Yeah. Any other concerns? Well, let us pray, and we will end with the Our Father that's already up on the screen, but we'll end with that together. And so let us pray. And as we begin this time of prayer, take a deep breath in and feel God's love and grace in your life. Oh God, we are here. We're not at the foot of the cross. We're not at that empty tomb, for those things happened so long ago. But we gather in this place at this time, both physically here at St. Andrew's and also on Facebook and later on YouTube. We gather together at the same time, giving you thanks and praise for the blessings that abound, for blessings and joys of family and celebrations, for things that occur that we didn't anticipate to occur, but that happens because you make the impossible the possible. So we give you thanks for those areas that are going well and joys abound. Oh God, we also come to this time and place in which our hearts are heavy. Maybe we're hungry. Maybe we're not quite sure how to pay that electric bill. Maybe our illness and our pain is overtaking us. Maybe there is healing that needs to occur and is not occurring fast enough. Or there's worry for upcoming surgeries. Or there's grieving in our hearts. Or trepidations of new beginnings in those places in which darkness resides, in which your presence seems to be lacking, in those areas in which the concerns overtake us and our emotions get us stuck. We come here in this moment to ask you to do what you do best, to work within us in ways that amaze and astound us. Work within us in ways that bring us peace and joy. Let us feel your love in those areas that we are concerned. Extend your healing hand and healing touch into our lives and into this world and into this country and into this virus specifically. Let healing occur in all ways, shapes, and forms. We give you thanks for the healing that has occurred, is occurring, and will occur. But, oh God, we know that in faith it will occur. That in faith healing occurs in so many ways. And so let us experience that healing. Let us experience that grace. And so speak to us today. Work within our hearts. Be with us in ways that let us know that you are present and you are alive. We offer all these prayers that were said verbally, but also the prayers of our hearts that were unsaid. We offer them to you, for we know that Scripture says that you care, and for us to cast our cares on you. And so let us feel your peace. Calm the storms in our lives, and let joy abound. Let those areas that seem not joyful become peaceful and calm in our lives. We do this because your Son, you, chose to show us your love through sacrifice. And so together as a community of faith, we share the same words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now that we pray in faith, let us affirm our faith.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. For the third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, sing with us, Here is a Liar.
Thank you. the scripture this morning from Romans, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by mercies of God, to present your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, and what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith of God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness.
The word of the Lord for all people.
Thanks be to God.
All right. So again, I had a performance last night, and I think strained my voice, so I apologize. Hopefully, it hold up. We are talking about using faith to refresh and restart. And isn't it amazing to bless water and then have a baptism after this, which is all about faith? I do want to quickly say one thing. Normally we have younger youth here. We'll do a quick children's message, but I only see older youth, so we'll just skip that section right now. Unless the older youth want to come up and just sit on the floor. Busy? So anyway, that's why we're not doing children's message right now. All right. So using faith to refresh and restart is what we're talking about. The letter to Romans, or the book of Romans, as we most usually talk about it, is an interesting item or book. And I often wonder what Paul was thinking when writing this. He never went to Rome. And in fact, we don't know much about the Roman church. But yet this book has been the foundation of theology and what it means to be a Christian than any other book, including the Gospels. And now, let's be clear. It's not like Paul just said, oh, it's raining. Let me write a few thoughts down about what Jesus did. No, this is a huge book, especially at a time where writing and recording were specialties. So this took him some time. Now, most scholars will break this book of Romans into two major parts. Part 1, chapters 1 through 11, are the justification by faith. And then chapters 12 through 15 is the transformed life, followed by a conclusion. So we pick up our story at the beginning of a transformed life. And Paul knocks it out of the park. Now, before we get into this, let's take a moment to think about who Paul is. He was a Sadducee. He was a temple guy. The law, a Jew. He knew the law. His whole family did. He was a protector of the temple. And so guess who he persecuted? He persecuted those who followed Jesus. He was relentless in that. But then all of a sudden, one day, he has this mystical experience with God, almost like a modern-day burning of the bush experience back then. And in this mystical experience, a complete transformation occurs and Christianity is born. You see, Paul is central to what you know and I know of what is the church and theology. And yet, we have no clue why he wrote this book. Yeah, there's speculation of him wanting to visit Rome. And yet, this book is about Rome. It's like a treatise, a manifesto, about the reason we need Jesus and why we all should follow. Like he's trying to convince people of the truth. It was like the first written version of A Few Good Men. If we've seen that movie, you'll remember these lines. Where Lieutenant Caffey says, Colonel Jessup, did you order the code red? And Judge Randolph says, you don't have to answer that. But yet Colonel Jessup says, I'll answer the question. You want answers. Lieutenant Caffey says, I think I'm entitled to them. Colonel Jessup says, you want answers. Lieutenant Caffey says, I want the truth. And we have the famous line, you can't handle the truth. Can you handle the truth? That's what Paul is writing about. Can you handle the truth? Paul couldn't for a majority of his life. But then he was transformed. And not only could he handle it, he lived it and he taught it. Can you relate? Where are you in living and knowing your faith? Are you questioning what the truth is? Are you unable to handle the truth? Or are you living it and teaching it? Now, before you answer that, the question is, what is the truth? And that's where it gets sticky. Because Paul begins, the truth is offering your body as a living sacrifice. And then he says, don't follow the world. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm not sure if I could do that. I mean, he's saying we can't enjoy this body. And I mean, just look at me. You know I enjoy it. Food and I, wow, we have a relationship. And it doesn't seem to want to end. And nothing gets in the way of it. But that's not good, is it? That's of this world. And the world is 24 hours. It's fun. There are things that make us say, we want this. And let's just say, I wasn't always a pastor. And I'm thanking God every day that Facebook and Twitter didn't exist when I was in college. And VHS tapes are a thing of the past that nobody kept. Or I wouldn't be here right now. Can you relate? Where have you let the world lead you in your life? It's fun, isn't it, to let the world lead you? But Paul is telling us right up front, no, that's not it. That's not what we should be doing, not the world. See, Paul knows because he was the world. He was the one that conformed, and then he experienced God in a way that let him know that the world is not where it's at. Can you relate? Have you had that experience to know the world isn't where it's at? Have you had that experience the way Paul did, a transformation, a conversion, to know that the world is not the way, but that God is? Oftentimes I envy Paul, because I haven't had that experience of the transformation he did. I've had conversion experience in my faith walk and journey, and I've grown, but not like Paul. You see, this world still feels good. TV shows that I can't stop watching. Food I can't stop eating. What can't you stop? Paul is challenging us to a faith of God and not of this world. Following the world means you can't hear God's calling. Can you relate? Following the world means you can't hear God's calling. And God is calling you. You. You, the one in pain. You, the one in abuse. You, the one in tears. You, the one on the street. You, the one in trauma. You, the drunk. You, the drug abuser. You, the one hooked on porn. You, the one that can't sit still. You, the one that's afraid. You, the one that's scared. You, the one that's alone. You, the one that is hungry. You, the one that is in danger. You, the one that is grieving. You, no matter who you are, God is calling you. No matter what is happening in your life, God is calling you. You, the one that is homebound, sitting there thinking, I can't do anything. But yes, you can. God is calling you. If you can pick up a phone and call someone and say God loves you, God is calling you. I bet you can. You, the one sitting here right now, busy with work and life and family. You, the one sitting here saying, I don't have the time. But yet you can find the 30 minutes to watch TV. I bet you can find 30 minutes to change the sign of the church. You being called by God, and when are you being called in this world so you can't hear God? Where do you need to let the world go and let God be in The only way we can do that is to be silent, to hear God. So where are you resisting God's calling? In fact, let us take 30 seconds of silence and listen for God. In this moment of silence, do you hear God calling you? Where is God calling you? Maybe you heard, maybe you didn't. It's maybe silencing the mind and listening. You see, that's what faith is all about, letting God speak to you. There was a time where I sat in the pews just like you, and I listened to this pastor preach. Somebody who was just about 10 miles down the road. You all probably know him. His name's Andy. We won't say much more about him. But as he sat there and preached one day, I started thinking, I was in a church that we didn't have a children's message, and we didn't have a children's church, but yet we had children in the service. And somehow, all I heard was God tugging at my heart to do a children's message. And so after he preached, I went up and said, I'll do this. And that morphed into not only a children's message, but a children's church and other people stepping up to take over. You see, God is calling you. But if you are of this world, you can't hear God. Where is God calling you? In your bulletins, there is a page of things that are needed in this church. Maybe God is tugging at your heart to say, I can do one of those things, or maybe part of one of those things. You see, you can't hear God's calling if you're of this world. And then in the scripture, we have Paul reiterating a philosophy of uniqueness, a philosophy that we need each other, that our uniquenesses are not meant to be in isolation. Paul was sure you need to follow God as a Sadducee and look at the impact he made. Paul is using the same concept of gifts. The Greek word charisma means grace or gifts denoting extraordinary powers, distinguishing Christians, enabling them to serve the church of Christ, the reception of which is due to the power and divine grace of the Holy Spirit. Your uniqueness is an extraordinary power. Have you ever considered your gifts are extraordinary powers? You have them. Everyone does. And Paul is saying, when we use them in humble ways, meaning we are all equals, we just serve different functions. We are living the faith life that God is calling us to go on. But when you're not trying to take over, but work together, faith excels, and the result is refreshing and restarting. Where do you need to refresh and restart in your faith journey? Where do you need to refresh and restart in sharing your gifts? Where do you need to be humble in sharing them, knowing that you are as important and equal with others? You see, when you and I begin to live a life that we are all equal and possess uniqueness, that is living in faith, that is living in God, then and only then, not do we not need the world. Where do you need to see your uniquenesses, the same with someone else's, as important, just different? Paul is reminding us that we need each other in our gifts. But so often we let our differences divide, and we justify, and we complain, and we tear down. I often don't hear many people saying thank you for what you did and your uniquenesses here, and I'm glad you're here. What I hear more of is this person did this or didn't do that, or we need this or we don't have enough of this. Can you imagine what this church would look like if we actually lifted each other up instead of focusing on what we don't have? Instead of focusing on what someone did or didn't do, Paul is reminding us that when we focus on this world, we are focusing on lack and not enough, and we're not being humble. But when we focus in faith on God, when we focus on our gifts and our uniquenesses as equal, we are focusing on God's way of living. We are one body but many parts. Where do you need to refresh and restart in your faith today? In the faith of living into your gifts, Now let's be clear, gifts are not skills. Not what you're already doing. Because what God is nudging you, pulling on your heart, is the doing of something that may have nothing to do of this world. But God is calling you, and you need to listen. I don't work with children. I work more with youth. But God nudged me to do a children's message one day, and it morphed into something bigger. In the same way, right after the pandemic, God nudged my heart to open up a prayer ministry within our conference. And now, it's a year and a half later, we are still praying every Tuesday for our conference. You see, when you listen and you hear God tugging your heart, amazing things will occur. That's the significance of this water we blessed. This is God calling each of us, nudging each of us to use our gifts. Not of this world, but of God. Faith is listening, not doing. Doing happens after you listen. Where are you hearing God tug at you? Where are you gifted and you don't know it? Where do you have skill, but maybe your gift is your skill or isn't? It doesn't matter, but our gifts are the things that God makes us unique in. You need to listen to God for your gift, and if you listen, you may be astonished at your gift. May you use faith and listen to refresh and restart. The key is to listen. Where is God tugging at your heart today? Listen and take action. You won't be disappointed. Amen. Amen. And as a response of where God is calling you, let us take a moment and where God is calling you for your presence, your gifts, your witness, your service, for all our offerings to God. And we will take the offering and then pray. Thank you. course of this place, let us remember that our purpose is to know, grow in, and share the love of Christ, with a vision of souls restored, nourished, and transformed, passionately serving Christ. And so leave this place with that purpose and vision, and remember, you can find a refreshing start in any area of your life with God, Jesus, the Holy Spirit. May you seek and find this week after week. And now hear these words of a covenant prayer in the Wesleyan tradition. I am no longer mine but yours. Put me to your will, place me with whom you will. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be put to work for you or set aside for you. Praise for you or criticize for you. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and fully surrender all things to your glory and service. And now, O wonderful and holy God, creator, redeemer, and sustainer, you are mine and I am yours, so be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it also be made in heaven. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.